So I recently watched an interview with Cherie Dimaline, author of the incredible new book, Empire of Wild, and she was talking about how stories connect us more than anything else, because stories are where we are the most vulnerable, most honest, and most thoughtful versions of ourselves. And with Empire of Wild, she hits these notes beautifully. This is a vulnerable, honest, and thoughtful book that I think you should read, so let's get into it. Empire of Wild follows Joan, a Métis woman whose husband, Victor, has disappeared for the last year after they had just this huge fight. He left the house and never returned. So the novel picks up a year later when he comes back with a new name, no memory of his past whatsoever, and a mission to bring his people to Jesus. So right away we're asking all kinds of questions. Is this actually Victor? If it is, why doesn't he remember anything about his past? And most importantly, why is this indigenous man working with evangelicals to convert his people? Like, what kind of person would deceive his own community like that? Well, turns out a roguaroo. That's fucking who. Dimaline's friend and fellow celebrated Canadian author, Eden Robinson, has compared this book to Neil Gaiman's American Gods. And that's because this book is a woman's search for her husband set against the backdrop of the Métis community's legends of the roguaroo. According to the stories, the roguaroos are essentially werewolf-like creatures that troll isolated indigenous communities. They are living nightmares that exist just outside of where these people live and pose this kind of ever-present threat. Dimaline's use of roguaroos in this story is just, it's so brilliant, because not only does it give this story like a supernatural dark fantasy element, which is really fun, but she uses that legend to illustrate some pretty dense political commentary. So to the Métis, the roguaroos are kind of a behavioral deterrent. I just love this. Like, boys and men who disrespect either women, the land, or their communities are told that if they behave this way, they can transform into a roguaroo themselves. Girls and women are taught not to kind of explore too far past their community boundaries because the roguaroo is out there kind of waiting for them. It's really a tremendous metaphor, and Dimaline just takes it one step further by bringing that legend into the ongoing oppression and colonization that is still very much happening throughout Canada and North America. And she does this through Victor, this indigenous man turned revivalist Christian missionary who's trying to take his own people away from their way of life and convert them to Christ. And the reason he's doing this is to soften the legal ground that his people are standing on, so this huge corporation can come along and build a pipeline through that area. I won't say how or why he's doing this. For that, you'll have to read the book. But that's essentially Joan's narrative through this story. Why is Victor doing this? And who is he doing this for? I can't speak to how things work in the United States, because I don't live there, but here in Canada, there is a very real and dangerous link between First Nations communities who are lured off their land and into the church, and the vulnerability of that land for resource development. So to see Dimaline take this issue and turn it into this like gritty love story that's also like a total sexual thriller, while somehow also exploring like indigenous life in Ontario today. It's just so fascinating and unbelievably impressive to me, and just so entertaining. It's just, it's incredible how intelligent and how gripping this book is at the same time. And I swear to God, it's funny. I'm just such a big fan of this book. Like, this is really important stuff. Sure, there's like werewolves and sex and this funny little pudgy 12-year-old sidekick named Zeus, but the ideas in this book just aren't talked about very much in white culture, and they should be. How Christianity has just worn away protections in indigenous communities to allow for resource extraction, because it's way easier to get approval for things like mines and pipelines when there's no like technical traditional indigenous use of that land. So in a very real way, the more Christian communities become, the more vulnerable and valuable that land becomes. I would absolutely recommend this book to anybody, and I almost never say that. It's sexy, it's terrifying, it's magical, it's fun, it's smart. And Joan, our main character, is a character worth reading because she will just fight tooth and nail for the things that she loves and will not be convinced by anybody that her story is not worth exploring. My name's Rick. Thank you so much for watching. Go read this book, and I'll see you in a couple days. Bye.